Hi, I'm Dr. Anjana Bada, and we are back on my channel talking all things aesthetics, and we have a super, super special guest today. It's my husband, who has willingly volunteered himself for some treatments. So we're going to do some male aesthetics. So the male aesthetic market has grown over 200%, I think, since 2017. I just have to fact check myself, but it is growing, and it's no longer taboo for male patients to want to enhance or restore their aesthetic appeal. Okay, so when we assess an aesthetic patient, it's important that they are sitting upright, because that's their position when they're standing, when they're facing people, and where you can, if you lie completely back, that's when flaws disappear. So everything, all the lines go away, and it gives you an incorrect perspective. So my husband's sitting up, looks so handsome. So, and what stands out for me on his face is his really strong jawline. So part of that is because genetically he has a strong jawline, but he also has something called a class 3 jaw, where your lower jaw is more forward than your upper jaw, and that leads to an appearance in the mid face, the middle of the face, where there's less volume. So there's a bit of loss of volume there, and his biggest concern is the under eye area, so looking tired. He doesn't want to look tired anymore, so that's what we're going to treat today. But with male aesthetics, what's different with female aesthetics is we can't overfill the male face. We can't give them these round cheeks that that women like and that look good on women, like my cheeks are round. He can't do that, and that won't look natural, and we have to keep the angles on a male face. So an angle going like this, I have to make sure that when I do the filler, it follows that path, but also that doesn't overfill this and demasculinize your male patient. So I am gonna enhance the cheek area, make it a strong angle, and then also you can see he's got some numbing cream on. He looks pretty stern, and I know he likes looking stern, but we're gonna relax that look a little bit with some botulinum toxin. And when we treat men, we have to be really mindful not to over-treat and make it look really smooth, like Simon Cowell. If you have a look at America's Got Talent, it's super smooth, and it actually makes his brows go like down and low, and you don't want that look. Okay, and with the male brow, different from the female brow, it's a little bit flatter, so it's important not to have that like end of the brow shooting down. So we're going to start with your treatments, both fillers are medical devices, and botulinum toxins are drug, and this is a practice, so it's important to consult before, go through an informed consent, because both these treatments come with benefits as well as risks. So I've made my markings, they're my personal markings, and they're going to guide me in terms of where I'm going to place the filler. Every doctor does it differently, and I haven't marked out any anatomical areas of interest, but you can, like in terms of the tear trough or the infraorbital foramen, where all the blood vessels are, and we have to be continually aware where these are all the time. Anatomy is variable, so in each patient it's different. So as we go along, safe practice while doing fillers is really important. With my husband, I'm going to use cannula. Cannula is a long blunt needle that if at the correct size and gauge is safer to use in certain areas than needles, and I'm also going to use that for under the eye, because using needles under the eye a lot of the time results in like bruising that can go on for quite some time. Cannula needle, there's no one that's better. Some people are better with cannula, some people are better than with needles, but it's a personal preference. I do use them both. I'm going to do the cheek first, and by doing the cheek, it gives some extra structure and support to the tear trough. The tear trough is this area here. It's what people call the under eye area, and they call it tear trough deformity. It's not actually deformity, it's normal anatomy, and some people are born with those deep tear troughs, so it's perfectly normal, and it's really important not to overfill the area. But by restoring the area, you do restore a bit of vitality. Patients don't look as tired.
This is Restylane Lift. We also shouldn't be saying filler names, but this is a hyaluronic acid filler. It is Nasha technology, and it is very, very, very lifting and structural. So really nice for cheeks, chins, jawlines. So this sticker is gonna go in this file. I'm going to attach a cannula to it because we're gonna do it with a cannula.
Turn slightly to this side for me. Okay, I'm just making sure the angle's correct. You okay?
Mm-hmm. Go.
You okay?
Mm-hmm.
So I must always know where the cannula is. Are you feeling all right, Rob?
Mm-hmm.
Is anything uncomfortable?
No.
Okay. So this has local anesthetic in it, so sometimes on injection you can also feel a little bit of burning. You must tell me if anything is uncomfortable or unusual feeling.
Mm-hmm.
You can even hear the filler going in. It kind of sounds like pop, 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 something like that. Go. And with filler, it's important to go nice and slow. In the cheek area, I also inject with a needle on the bone, but I'm not going to do that yet. So if you want to, they call it top model cheekbones. That come already has a very strong facial structure. It's just a bit of loss of volume in the mid face. You okay? So you can see this is more of an angular injection path, and with women, I usually do more of a teardrop. So a curvier sort of injection. Because this filler is so robust, you do feel it for a couple of days in your cheek. You feel the gel. And I'm going to use a whole vial on one side to get enough volume replacement. And you can actually see the tissue move up, and you can even see a small improvement in the tear trough. We're going to do that separately though with a lighter filler. Sorry, this is an alcohol swab. I have to swab it. And then you put it straight and we mold. So we're trying to retain that angular structure, and the whole thing is to be subtle. You know, you don't want people to be like, oh, what did you do? It's a subtle improvement, and this actually looks better after 2 weeks and even after 4 weeks. It improves the condition of your skin. Okay. And then also in certain areas, placing filler in certain areas may cause an effect called myomodulation. So often when we do the cheek area, you find that the crow's feet looks a bit better. So when people do the chin, it creates almost a lift in the face. So fillers are very versatile and relatively safe procedures, and they also last after 12 months. It's a really nice procedure to have done. Okay, Bev. Better?
Mm-hmm.
So there are some ligaments here. If the patient is uncomfortable, it's important to draw back and find a better path of least resistance. And also to put some filler down with lidocaine so it makes it more comfortable. This filler that I'm using, so how we get around not saying the name, we say the technology that's used. It's called NASHA technology. It's non-animal derived and it's stabilized. And each little filler particle is the exact same size. Why I like it, especially this one, it's got, they call it the highest G prime. So it's got amazing lift, amazing elasticity, and it's really, really nice for these areas that are under a lot of muscle pressure, the cheeks, the chin, the jawline, and people also use it in noses for structural, to give that very distinct structure. And this particular filler brand was the first filler brand to be FDA approved. You okay there?
Mm-hmm.
What to expect after a filler treatment? Some people actually get a headache from it. The next day, as you can see, we're going in and out, we might inject on the bone, so there will be some sensitivity, a feeling that there's some gel there, and of course some swelling, and possibility of any injection in the body can lead to bruising, but I don't think there'll be any of that here. Just got some hypochlorous on my hands to do the molding. Can use also antiseptic cream. If you're comfortable, you're right.
Mm-hmm.
You feel okay?
Mm-hmm.
So the under eye area, even though it's a bit nerve-wracking for the patient, you're right under their eye, is also a bit more comfortable than doing areas like the cheek and the chin. You okay?
Mm-hmm.
Also with these sort of procedures, I also like building the skin around the eye first. In terms of topical procedures, peels, microneedling, that sort of thing. And Kuskomo's tear trough is relatively deep. You go into underfall and then you'll probably need maybe two more sessions.
So with dark under eye circles, as they're commonly known, versus tear troughs, there are a few causes. One is thinning of the skin. It's the thinnest skin in the body. And so any friction, any irritation results in post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, as well as there's the blood vessels that show through and make it, like, give it this bluish tinge, a loss of volume. So when we do this treatment, one aspect of it would be fillers. After tear trough filler treatment, I often tell my patients they welcome to ice the area, and the easiest way is putting two clean spoons in the fridge or freezer and using them as ice packs to sleep on more than one pillow. So when you do your cheeks and when you do your under eye, more prone to swelling in that area post-treatment for a few days. Okay, so thank you for joining me once again for our aesthetic adventures. We've just done a male filler and toxin treatment. So it's a process that happens in stages, and aesthetic procedures you build. It's a journey that you go on. And thank you to my very handsome patient for letting us treat him today. I hope that he loves it, and then going forward 2 weeks it'll keep on improving. So I'm really excited to see the results. If you have any questions about the procedures, or if you'd like to see something special, drop us a comment down below, like and subscribe. Thank you.